National Interest this week returns to full-fledged strategic affairs. And let me start it with a strategic affairs quiz. The first question is simple. 1974, Pokhran 1. So what is the code that was used by Mrs. Gandhi's aides to inform her that the Pokhran 1 nuclear test was successful? I know everybody knows the answer. That is, Buddha is smiling. Now let me ask you a follow-up question. Would you know why that expression, that code, Buddha is smiling, was chosen? Was it chosen just randomly as something nobody will figure out? Or was there a thought process behind it? So while you think about it, mull over it, let's switch to Ukraine, because that is what has caused this week's thought process to happen. Now, by the time you are watching or hearing this, Kyiv would have capitulated one way or the other. The question that's been asked often in the past few days and will continue to echo for days to come is, would it have been so simple for Putin's Russia to crush Zelensky's Ukraine if it hadn't given up its nuclear stockpile after the Budapest Accord in 1994? This was done in return for security guarantees by the US, by Europe and Russia. One of the guarantors, that is Russia, has now invaded Ukraine. One, Europe is looking for a place to hide and rueing its possible loss of cheap gas from Russia. And the third, the US is doing no more than pour tender love and care, or speaking brave words which mean nothing. Would Ukraine be such a pushover if it had that nuclear stockpile? Serious question. Now, let's turn this question inwards at ourselves. Was India prescient or imprudent to not only build nuclear weapons, but to declare itself a nuclear-armed state? Over the decade, this has been a robust debate among four schools. One, the Homi Bhabha era hawks, who believe India should have built its nukes in the early 60s, even preempting China if that was possible. Former Foreign Secretary Maharaj Krishan Raskotra, who had worked very closely with the Gandhi family through the various generations, he had even stated in public interviews and seminars that US President John F. Kennedy had once offered to help India develop and detonate a nuclear device, but that Jawaharlal Nehru turned him down. The second school is the opposite. Nuclear weapons are ugly, immoral, unusable, unnecessary, and an affront to humanity. That school has faded lately, especially after India's Pokhran 2 tests in 1998. Now, some of that school has morphed into a new thought process, which is, now that nuclearization is a done deal, let's work to keep it to minimum deterrence and be active and willing members of all global arrangements, including something like CTBT, that is Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty of sorts. The third school believes that India was better served by nuclear ambiguity, that Indira Gandhi had already shown the world our capability in 1974 with Pokhran 1. The 1998 tests were unnecessary political chest thumping. That gave Pakistan the opportunity and excuse to test their weapons as well. As a result, South Asia suddenly had two self-declared nuclear weapon states. Was that the best thing for India? The fourth school is the team that actually won the argument in India, that a mere demonstration of capability in 1974 was not enough. It was self-inflicted double defeat. India exposed itself to sanctions and yet did not assert itself as a nuclear weapons power. To call this peaceful nuclear explosion or PNE was pure hypocrisy that impressed no one. Not even India's public opinion at a juncture when Mrs. Gandhi desperately needed something to shore it up. It was essential to weaponize. That's why they say it was essential to weaponize, thump our chests, throw the gauntlet at Pakistan. The first school did not find much purchase in the fraught 1960s. The second was rendered irrelevant after 1998. The third and the fourth need to be debated, particularly with the Ukraine issue or Ukraine fate staring us in the face. Similar questions were also raised when the US invaded Iraq twice, the second time on the pretext that it had nukes. Now, if Iraq actually had nukes, would any Bush, senior or junior, have risked invading it? Now, Iraq may not have the wherewithal to get any nuclear weapons or weapons of mass destruction to America, to Washington, New York, any place like that. But that wouldn't have mattered because all they needed to do was to threaten to detonate one over any of the Middle Eastern allies of the United States. You can pick the name of the allies, and you know, all of them are next door to Iraq. Would have been very easy if they had the bomb, at least to make the threat. Ukraine now, therefore, has become an enduring advertisement for the WMD, that is Weapon of Mass Destruction, Sovereignty Link. So the two things have now become hyphenated. Nuclear weapons and sovereignty, like it or not, that is the post-Ukraine reality. It's making many nations comfortable until now in the aura of guarantees, uncomfortable. Surely no country with the nukes now, or one that's nearly there, North Korea, Israel, Iran, or any other, will ever give these up. They will remember Ukraine. Now, did India gain or lose from opening its nuclear cupboard and exposing its wares to the world? The criticism is that enabled Pakistan to find formal parity. The answer is nobody had any doubt that Pakistan was already a nuclear weapon state. The Americans had given their last certificate of what we might call, or what is usually called in the proliferation circles or anti-proliferation circles, certificate of quote-unquote nuclear virginity. They had given the last one to Pakistan in 1989 and refused to renew it thereafter. In the 1990-91 standoff between India and Pakistan, one of the many periods when we nearly came to war, Pakistan had also employed the nuclear blackmail against India. It is something that books have been written about. So Bob Bindrum and William Burroughs, two investigative journalists in America, they wrote a book titled Critical Mass: The Dangerous Race for Superweapons in a Fragmenting World. And then CIA Deputy Chief Robert Gates has spoken about it. Also, investigative journalist Seymour Hersh has written a detailed piece too. I too have explained it in several of my writings since then, going right back to 1990. But the Pakistani threat which Bob Gates brought to India was stark. And that threat was that in case there is a war now, he had come to India to make peace. Washington had sent him to India and Pakistan to make peace. He went to Pakistan first, and the Pakistanis told him to give this message to India that if there is a war now, not only will they use the nukes, but they will use their nukes early in the war, in the beginning of the war. In fact, there is a conversation that I have quoted in the past when Mr. Gujral was around, whereby he said that Sahibzada Yaqub Khan, his Pakistani counterpart as foreign minister, he came visiting to India and he said, Gujral sahab, ab ye jang nahi karna, nahi to aisi aag lagegi. You will see the fires that you have not imagined before. Your rivers, your mountains, everything will be on fire. And Gujral sahab responded to him by saying, ke, Yaqub sahab, humne bhi unhi daryaon ka pani piya hai, jinka aapne piya hai. We've been brought up on the water of the same rivers as you, so it's not as if we'll be pushovers. But the harsh reality had dawned on BP Singh's government then that India did not have an immediately deliverable weapon of retaliation. Over the decades, proven capability had not been developed into a credible weapon and delivery systems. There was complacency. That crisis passed, the 1990-91 crisis passed, but this had ended any doubts across our political spectrum with all its divisions that India needed to weaponize fast. India needed the weapons fast. 18 March 1989 is a significant day in India's strategic evolution. Remember, this is early 1989. Rajiv Gandhi is about 6 months away from his election. On this day, that is 18th March 1989, the IAF, Indian Air Force, was holding its customary firepower demonstration, this one involving 129 aircraft at a place called Tilpat, which is a big firing range not far from Delhi. At the demonstration, Rajiv Gandhi gestured to top civil servant Naresh Chandra, who's been India's cabinet secretary, home secretary, governor of Gujarat, ambassador to the US, etc., etc. He gestured to him to follow him into a tent. He was so secretive, he even shook off a curious Rajesh Pilot, who was then a minister. There he told Chandra of his concern and assigned to him to head an elite group, mostly of scientists, to take India to full weaponization. I wrote about it in some detail in two 2006 articles. In fact, I am sharing the links with you. The group included top nuclear scientists R. Chidambaram, P. K. Iyengar, Anil Kakodkar, K. Santi Santhanam, missile man A. P. J. Abdul Kalam, and then DRDO chief V. S. Arunachalam. They were to be funded mostly covertly out of a fund, a nondescript fund called Science and Technology, which was controlled by the Planning Commission, and the Finance Ministry was given instructions that anytime Chandra comes asking for any money, just release it without asking any questions from this fund. A lot of the operations were undercover and covert. Santhanam, for example, was given a discreet senior posting in RAW, R-A-W. Kakodkar later disclosed to me in a Walk the Talk interview, of which I'll share a link with you, that he had to travel overseas under assumed names and passports. Now, that baton passed flawlessly and brilliantly between seven prime ministers across a decade of political instability. India had a decade of daily wage prime ministers, but this program was not affected. And in 1998, Pokhran 2 happened, followed by Pakistan's tit for tat in Chagai. 2 decades after that, where did the two new nuclear powers end up? India mostly accepted as a responsible, legitimate nuclear weapons power, admitted to most multilateral nuclear arrangements, rid of all the sanctions, and now declared an American strategic ally. And Pakistan? It wasn't such a bad idea to open the cupboard then, because Pakistan is still frozen in many ways where it was after the Chagai tests in 1998. So once again, was it such a bad idea to open that nuclear cupboard? I don't think so. Finally, here is the answer to the second question in our quiz. Or why did they say Buddha is smiling for Pokhran 1? It seems that sometime in the epoch of Buddha, the ancient kingdom of Magadha launched a war of conquest over its neighbor Vaishali. Now the folklore again is that this was a war because the ruler of Magadha, that is Ajatshatru, really coveted the chief courtesan of Vaishali, who was Amrapali. But that's folklore. The history, however, is that Magadha did invade Vaishali. Now, while Magadha was the usual monarchy that built a big army and collected the weapons for the assault, Vaishali was some kind of an anarchic street democracy where everything was decided on the street, where everybody thought he was the king and nobody listened to the king, and king also left it to people. Democracy some 300-400 years before BC, you see, that's how it was. People spent all their time arguing over whether to fight, how to fight, who will fight. Sure enough, Magadha annihilated and massacred poorly armed Vaishali. When the news got to a meditating Buddha, it seems he frowned in disapproval, meaning that to keep the peace, Buddha was a man of peace, but he also suggested that to keep the peace, a kingdom has to be fully prepared for war as a deterrent, or it will meet Vaishali's fate. Since 1964, when the Chinese carried out their first test, India was the Vaishali to China's Magadha. Now you know why Buddha would be smiling now in 1974 when India had got parity, or why he would be frowning at Ukraine's fate now.